Here's hoping that the conditions will improve significantly over the next few months so that we'll be able to get back to traveling. I'm especially looking forward to visiting Amsterdam in the late summer with Kosher River Cruises. Amsterdam is such a fascinating city in Jewish history. And let's just take a few minutes right now to talk about one of the figures who appeared in Amsterdam in the 18th century, the incredible Rabbi Moshe Hayim Luzzatto. And I think one of the most amazing things about the connection between Amsterdam and the Ramchal, as he is known, the acronym of his name, is that Amsterdam was a city of refuge for many who were persecuted. Not only, as we saw in previous videos, some of the Portuguese conversos who were forced to accept Christianity and then wanted to return to their own Jewish identities and could not do so in the Iberian Peninsula. They had to find a safer location. Amsterdam was one of those locations, and we see it in particular with Rabbi Moshe Chaim Luzzatto. So first of all, who was Rabbi Luzzatto? He was a child prodigy, a genius who wrote quite a few really stellar works of Jewish literature that made a phenomenal impression on many different segments of Jewish intellectual life in the 18th century. Perhaps he is most well known for a book called Mesilat, Yesharim, The Path of the Just, which was regarded as an absolutely incredible sort of self-help guide, an ethical guide, a masterful statement of Jewish morality, and a way in which it could be applied to an individual in a personal program of development. I myself enjoy it tremendously. I've studied it many times, and every time I make my way through it, I feel some incremental growth in my own personality and a desire to read it yet again. His work was accepted amazingly well across the spectrum, at least when you look over the course of the 18th century and onward. For example, there's a remarkable diversity of people who really enjoyed the Ramchal. There was the famous Moses Mendelssohn, who was a maskil, an Enlightenment figure, who argued that Jews should engage more fully with secular non-Jewish culture, that Judaism had something to offer the general European world, and that even European studies in culture and literature, art, music, science, and so on, could also enrich the Jewish perspective of the world. He had a tremendous respect for the Ramchal. Also in the world of literature, the famous professor at Hebrew University, Joseph Klausner, argued that the Ramchal was actually the first modern Hebrew writer that was actually producing works of fiction. In fact, he was a playwright in modern Hebrew, and that all modern Hebrew literature stems from this one 18th century thinker. For those who are very close students of the Ramchal, they'll know that actually one of his most cherished areas of intellectual activity was the Kabbalah, mysticism. And it is in this regard in particular that he's especially beloved by Hasidim. The Maggid of Mezrich, for example, one of the most important early Hasidic leaders, argued that the generation was not worthy to understand the Ramchal, that he was such a tremendously important figure. And on the other side of the Jewish spectrum, we've already talked about Maskilim, we've talked about Hasidim, the Vilna Gaon, the great Litvak, the Lithuanian traditionalist thinker, who in many ways was opposed to the Hasidim, also found the Ramchal's work incredibly valuable. He once famously wrote that there is not a single word out of place in the Mesilat Yesharim until chapter 11. And what that word is, maybe if we have a chance to learn together, I'd like to share with you what I think it would be. The Vilna Gaon also said that if he were alive at the same time as the Ramchal, their lifespans just overlapped very slightly, he would have walked all the way from Lithuania to Padua in Italy to study with him. The biography of the Ramchal is phenomenal. As I mentioned, he came from Padua in northern Italy, where he was regarded as a child prodigy. He wrote his first book at the age of 14. He wrote on grammar, on linguistics. He actually wrote one of the first, books of how to engage in public speaking. He wrote quite a bit of poetry and so on. And he actually attracted to himself a remarkable number of medical students at the University of Padua, which was one of the few schools in Europe that would admit Jewish students. They had some interesting kind of disabilities. They had to pay more tuition. They had to offset some of the expenses of non-Jewish students and so on. But at any rate, they could earn a medical degree at Padua. And so some of the brighter Jewish medical students who had traveled from all over Europe were attracted to a special circle that that formed around the Ramchal specifically to study Kabbalah. However, this attracted a lot of undue attention, particularly when the Ramchal started expressing some more radical ideas about Kabbalah, which are beyond the scope of this very short video. But he was attacked in particular by a figure named Rabbi Moshe Hayim, who thought that this young individual, who was in his early 20s at the time, was actually a secret follower of the disgraced Shabbatai Tzvi, shown here, who led a disastrous messianic movement in the 17th century that resulted in the disappointment of hundreds of thousands of Jews all around the world, who had thought that this might actually be the moment when Jews will return to Jerusalem. It was so amazing how widespread Shabbatai Tzvi's movement was, as you can see in some of these woodcuts, that even non-Jews were talking about it because they saw so many Jews, you know, selling their properties, including in Amsterdam, where he had a very large following, and preparing to pick up and move to Israel. However, Shabbatai Tzvi, when he confronted the Ottoman Sultan, was given the alternative of continuing in his quest and losing his head, or converting to Islam. Shabbatai Tzvi decided to convert to Islam, disappointing so many of his followers, although a small number of them actually continued, believing that if their purported Messiah had converted to Islam, then perhaps that meant they should do so as well. They became a sect known as the Dunme, who were active right up into the 20th century in politics in Turkey, for example. But back to the Ramchal. Rabbi Moshe Hayim felt that the Ramchal was actually a secret follower of Shabbatai Tzvi, and he raised the issue with the Jewish court in Venice that actually looked at the Ramchal, and they were somewhat troubled by what they saw because he was remarkably young. You know, Kabbalah is usually only studied by people at least of the age of 40. He was still unmarried. And in fact, he did not grow a beard, which was one of those things that bothered them. And so they insisted on interviewing him, and they made him promise that he would restrict his Kabbalistic teachings. And when he got married, that actually assuaged some of their concerns, so they let it be. After some time, however, this rankled the Ramchal, and he felt that he really wanted to continue teaching Kabbalah. And so there were also some family reversals in business. And so he decided to leave Padua and travel north in Europe to find a more secure income. He moved to Frankfurt, but Rabbi Moshe Hayim, who was unhappy with the fact that the Ramchal was let off without too many consequences in Padua, he sent letters ahead to Frankfurt, telling the authorities there that they should arrest the Ramchal on suspicion of following Shabbatai Tzvi, and they had a second trial there in Frankfurt. He was once again forced to submit to a humiliating oath indicating he would not teach Kabbalah and so on, and perhaps most tragically, the Frankfurt Beit Din seized all of his unpublished manuscripts in order to examine them for possible heresy, and finding none but still uncertain of their content, they decided to bury them as if to hide them away, and then they lost the site of their burial. And so many of the Ramchal's phenomenal works are lost to history until perhaps one day they will be unearthed. The teacher of the Ramchal, Rabbi Isaiah Bassan, marshaled a tremendously heroic defense of his student, arguing that there was no reason for him to be persecuted on these suspicions. He was an incredibly upright and especially talented young man. And so in the end, after he took the second oath, they allowed him to travel on. And it was finally in Amsterdam where he found some rest. As we've spoken about in a couple previous videos, the Portuguese Jews in Amsterdam in particular had a predominant influence on admitting the Ramchal and giving him the respect he needed and a place to teach. He had an honored position and so on. And he enjoyed some of the best years of his life, of his short life, were in Amsterdam, because they saw, among other things, not only his brilliance, but also they recalled some of the negative repercussions of the situation with Uriel Acosta that we spoke about previously. And also, not too far in the distance, was the excommunication of Spinoza, which engendered some controversy as well. So the Ramchal was allowed to teach and study and write in Amsterdam, and it is there that he wrote his remarkable work, the Mesilat Yesharim. One thing that I'm especially excited about, if you haven't studied the Ramchal in a while, perhaps it was when you were in yeshiva, you had an opportunity to study the Ramchal, in the 1990s, a new version, an autographed version, meaning written in the Ramchal's own hand, was discovered in the archives in the former Soviet Union. And this version is not like the one that has been studied for the last 200-300 years. It was a dialogue version in which the entire, you know, theme and plot of Mesilat Yesharim is expressed in terms of two old friends who reunite after many years apart. One of them has kind of gone on, it's not an exact comparison, but it's kind of become like a modern Orthodox Jew, still very observant, but at the same time quite engaged in secular culture. And on the other hand, his old high school friend has become like a super chassid, you know, says Tehillim all day, recites Psalms all day, and very, very pious, very, very particular about their observance of the halacha. And the two of them get together and they start talking about their comparative experiences, and it is brilliant. It's so insightful. In many ways, I prefer the dialogue version, which the Ramchal decided not to publish, to the version that has been available. So much fascinating stuff. At any rate, I hope that you'll be able to join me on this cruise. We're definitely going to look at the Mesilat Yesharim because of its connection to Amsterdam. And I try to understand a little bit more of his thought and what he had to offer the world. Thank you very much for watching, and hope to see you on a cruise one day.